Hi, I'm Saturn Brownie, and this is Finding Happy Podcast. Finding Happy Podcast is my journey to discovering my own happiness through conversations with other persons who inspire me in one way or another. This podcast is about connecting with self to create possibilities and opportunities for happiness.
You deserve peace of mind. You deserve wellness. You deserve laughter. You deserve to smile. You deserve peace of mind. You deserve calm in your world. Your life isn't happening to you. You are life. Your happiness is not something you attain. You are. You generate happiness. You are your joy. You are the producer of your joy. You are the producer of your happiness. You deserve to be happy. So you go find it. Go find your happy at any cost. Risk it all for your own happiness. Find your happy.
Hi, thank you so much for joining me on Finding Happy Podcast. I am Saturn Brownie, and it is such a pleasure for me to be here with you today to have conversations around mindfulness, happiness, and living a meaningful life. So today the topic I'm focusing on is mastery of mind for contentment. I think it's very important for us to understand the workings of the mind and how it impacts our life, our outlook, and by extent our actions, and how that influences our world, impact our world, create our world, right? Now, after completing my coaching certification program with Career Coach Institute, my trainer Marsha Bench, I learned so much. And I wish as a child in primary school, I wish I had the opportunity to speak with a coach and to understand contentment and to understand how to navigate my world without making myself vulnerable, because no, I have no regrets. Let me make that clear. I have no regrets about the life I've led. I have gone through poverty and I'm still surviving. And I'm now at a place where I am proud of myself for having survived, right? For a long time, I wasn't proud of myself because I didn't feel like I was surviving at all. But now I own it because I've done the work, right? But I wish that as a kid growing up that I understood some of the things I'm going to talk to you about in this conversation. And that's the purpose for this podcast, to have the kind of conversations I wish I had when I was younger. And I hope, it's my hope, that young people listen to this podcast and take from it what they will. Yes, because had I learned this, I would have made better choices. I would have made more informed choices, so that my life now would not be so difficult and taxing sometimes because of the choices I made when I was younger. Choices, if I understood mindfulness, contentment, happiness, and was focused on being happy, I wouldn't have made the choices that I made. Most of my choices were made based on my being motivated by my need. And so I attracted more needs. Anyway, let's get into it. So Buddhist teachings recommend adjusting your wants to what you have rather than basing your happiness or contentment on your desires, the things you want to have. The Oxford Dictionary defines contentment as a state of happiness and satisfaction. So here's what I say. Quit worry. Quit worrying and choose contentment. In an article by Earl Nightingale, research shows that 92% of the things people worry about either never happen, has already happened, or is petty or irrelevant. Think about that. It is unnecessary abuse of your mental well-being. I believe that worry, the Bible says it rots the bone. I think it's a total waste of your mental space, of your mind, of your mental capacity. The article outlines the following. 1, 40% of the things you worry about will never occur anyway. Interesting, right? 40% of the things you worry about will never happen anyway. Number 2, 30% are things over and past that can't be changed by all the worry in the world. So no matter how much you worry about it, you will never be able to change it. Number three, 12% is needless worries about our health. And finally, 10% is petty, miscellaneous worries. Petty. Therefore, only 8% of your worries are worth concerning yourselves about, right? So, and instead of worrying about it, get up and do something about it. Do anything. And you know what I hope? I hope for a world where failure is more tolerated and supported, because you've got to fail to discover what works. And if you don't try, if you don't risk failure, then you never live. We should consider that. Yes? How you see it, you create it. Earl Nightingale in The Essence of Success states, "Our individual worlds will respond to us in the way in which we see them. They will become for us what we expect of them. We are the creators of our existence." Let me read that again. Our individual worlds will respond to us in the way in which we see them. They will become for us what we expect of them. We are the creators of our existence. The Forrott Group and William H. Bagley, in their workbook on leadership for the millennium and beyond, shared a dialogue captured by prolific writer Carl Sandburg, and I'm going to share it with you because I found it so profound. I was able to connect with it. This is something that I'm very familiar with, and I think you're going to be able to connect with it too. So here we go. The dialogue begins. "As the sudbuster leaned on his gate post, peering at the horizon and contemplating what corn might do next year, and why God ever made the grasshopper, and why 2 days of hot winds smothered the life out of a stand of wheat, a newcomer pulled up in a covered wagon. 'What kind of folks live around here?' he asked. 'Well, stranger,' said the sodbuster, 'what kind of folks was there in the country you came from?' 'Well, there was mostly a low-down, lying, thieving, gossiping, backbiting lot of people.' After a few seconds of reflection, the sodbuster replied, 'Well, I guess, stranger, that's about the kind of folks you'll find around here.' The stranger had just about blended into the dusty gray cottonwoods, becoming a clump on the horizon, when another newcomer pulled up. 'What kind of folks live around here?' the stranger asked. And again, the sodbuster replied, 'Well, stranger, what kind of folks was there in the country you came from?' The friendly stranger said with a smile, 'Well, they was mostly a decent, hard-working, law-abiding, friendly lot of people.' And again, the sodbuster said, 'Well, I guess, stranger, that's about the kind of folks you'll find around here.' And the station wagon moved off and blended with the dusty gray cottonwoods on the horizon, while the early sodbuster leaned at his gatepost and tried to figure out why 2 days of hot winds smothered the life out of a nice stand of wheat." Interesting. I hope you enjoyed that dialogue. Your world interacts with you in the way you interact with your world. For positive outcomes, you have to consciously invest positive thoughts, feelings, and actions. Today we have a very special guest. He is a renowned journalist and broadcaster. His name is Garfield Burford. He is one of the most consciously positive person I have ever known. In fact, it was his approach to life that changed mine, unbeknown to him. My acceptance of happiness changed the day he told me he was content in response to my asking him, "How are you?" Welcome, Garfield. So let me just give you the premise of the podcast. It's called Finding Happy. Mm-hmm. And its foundation is on three principles: thoughts, mm-hmm. feelings, and actions. Mm-hmm. Where the concept is, your thoughts are what you create,
Your feelings are the beliefs or the meanings you give to those ideas or perceptions or paradigms that you create. Mm-hmm. And then the actions that you take is the manifestation of what you feel. So it's in essence saying that you are the determinant of your outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. So that's the premise. It doesn't mean that you have to believe it or anything like that. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you that. Premise of it.
Excellent.
Right?
Excellent.
Okay, good. So, well, let me first say welcome to the podcast. I said welcome, right?
Yes.
And
yes,
my first question again is going to be, how are you doing today?
I'm fabulous, actually. Yes. A long, regular morning, a routine morning with a mixture of work and a mixture of making sure that everything is fine. So it has been actually a decent morning, except the challenges that we had with the gremlins in the system. For us to make this connection for you to be able to hear me. I think apart from that, I'm fine.
Okay, wonderful. Mm-hmm. The reason I invited you to the podcast is because unbeknown to you, you had an impact on my life.
Mm.
Because usually I never took note of the question, how are you doing? Until I started taking note of when you kept responding. Whenever I asked you how you were, and this was back in about 2016, you'd always say, I'm fabulous, I'm fantastic, all that good stuff. And I was annoyed. I never said, but I was annoyed. Yeah. I was like, nobody's life is that perfect. Like, it doesn't happen that way. But then one day you said to me, I'm content. And I thought to myself, okay, so it's not that he's saying I have a perfect life, but he's choosing to see it that way. And so when you said content to me, my interpretation was, okay, so it's not the perfect day today, but I'm still going to be okay. I don't know if that's what you intended, but that's what I understood from it. And I spoke about it on my podcast. And then a multiple of persons said to me, so you should bring him on to talk about it. So
excellent. I think, and thanks for the opportunity. I really appreciate it. I think that you've encapsulated it perfectly. I think that's what it is about. It is about ensuring that you're able to define your own reality. I think too often people allow their realities to define them as opposed to them defining their realities. You essentially create your own construct and your own construct surrounding how happy you are. In other words, you should not let circumstances determine how happy you are or how whether or not you're happy or not. You should be the one to determine that. And I think that was inherent in my statement to you. That in other words, no matter what was happening extraneously, I did not allow those extraneous factors to determine whether or not I was okay. I was contented. So the matter of contentment is an inner construct and an inner paradigm and does not depend on what are the external realities. And I think that's what it comes down to. And I think people have the wrong idea of what it is to be contented, to be happy. They believe that there are some of these extraneous factors. For example, the amount of money you have, the amount of material possessions that you have, the number of friends you have, for example, your social media profile and so on. No, these things are extraneous factors.
You're hitting social media?
No, I'm not. Whereas I'm not necessarily an ardent fan of it, I also understand and appreciate its value. So I would not necessarily take a pot shot at it. But my point is, I think generally what it is that you have to define and determine your own paradigms of happiness and contentment and not let other factors external to yourself that you have no control over impact on whether or not you're happy or sad.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That is a little bit easier said than done for persons, I think, especially who, having done coaching, right, my certification in coaching, I've learned so much. And what you said is so true. And I wish as a teen, I knew I had that kind of understanding, because a lot of the decisions and the choices I made, I have no regrets, but I would have made more informed decisions. And when I say informed, I mean more informed based on who I am rather than external forces. So give us a little of your background, who you are, what you do, so we can understand as you say this, how you came to this perspective.
Yeah, I think, and by the way, it would not be a relatively recent construct or concept. In other words, this is how I've always been. I've always adopted the view that you should determine your own reality. So I'm a journalist, I'm a broadcast journalist. I've been a broadcast journalist for roughly 20 years. I started out in radio production. So I would have started out at Nationwide News Network in around about 90, between 98 and 99. And as well, I was going to sixth form at St. Mary High School. And then from that, I went on into community broadcasting, community television broadcasting, where I was the coordinator of a local community channel in St. Mary called Northeastern Satellite Services. From then, I moved on to national terrestrial television, where I was a broadcast journalist at CBN Television, went up through the ranks until I became news manager in 2011, spent about 4 years as news manager there. And now I am a consultant as a considered head of news, sports, current affairs at ABS Television in Antigua, as a state-owned broadcaster in Antigua. So the point I'm making is, this has always been my reality. Broadcast journalism is always
How do you maintain passion. Such a reality in news? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, that's
how
fine.
Do you maintain that kind of mindset in our roller coaster news life?
Again, in mathematics, there's a concept of a common denominator. So no matter what the numbers are, there's a common denominator. In other words, something that always runs as a thread throughout everything that can be used to essentially define everything. Everything is an anchor around that. Your anchor has to be who you are, who your inner self is. And I think that's, in other words, that inner self then determines whether, for example, you see the glass as half empty or as half full. And I think that's a critical point. In other words, what that comes to, whether you see the glass as half full or as half empty, it is a matter of purely your perspective, purely your mindset, purely your vista on life, what prism through which you view life. That is what determines what essentially how your outlook is on life. That comes, as I said, purely from inside. How do you cultivate that inner strength, conviction?
That's my next thing, because I'll tell you this. I did not really know who I was until 2016. Okay, and it's not that I was driven by the circumstances and the things that were happening to me. And I think what happens is, especially when you come from a place of survival and you're constantly on this survival track, I now understand how my motivation was anchored in that. And so a lot of persons are motivated by their need. And that's what sometimes trips us up, but we don't know. And that's why it was so important, because that was the thing. It was content that changed my entire thing. That was what gave me the quantum shift. And I don't even think you knew. Well, I know you didn't know when it happened. Because that question is a question that people ask all the time. I used to come up with ways. I've changed my days and rearranged them. Just come up with ways to answer that question so as not to give the typical answer. And when I heard, when you were the one who, every time I asked, you'd respond in such a way, and I used to talk about it, but I never heard it from anybody else. How did you sound as though you knew pretty soon and pretty early who exactly you, how did you come about that? I mean, it may have been easy or natural for you, but for those who it's not so natural for.
Yeah, I think
so
it has to
quite
be.
Unique.
Yes, I think there has to be a kind of a focus on an anchor. In other words, who it is that you are going to be on the inside, and that is the anchor who is going to essentially be the tether that ties you to your goals, your dreams, your perspectives. You have to come up with a strong sense of self, and that strong sense of self.
Sorry.
Yeah.
How did you have such a great self-concept so early, sixth form?
Right. I think I was very clear from that. Perhaps it might be my family upbringing. Perhaps it might be my strong faith, and perhaps an amalgam of both. But I think background is important, and I think that I was able to have that from my family background, from a very strong, stable family, especially a mother figure who was extraordinarily strong in terms of cultivating that sense of self. Self-worth, self-determination,
okay.
And so on. And then, of course, my faith would have been an immense anchor to really reinforce that. to be the tether to make sure that that is tied together. So with that, and of course, for my own reading, for my own research, I've done a lot of reading early, from a very early age, especially on great figures throughout history. And everybody who knows me knows I talk about Alexander the Great a lot.
Yes, you do.
And he was one of the persons who, throughout history, apart from his military genius, apart from the fact that he was one of the greatest military minds the world has ever seen, to such an extent that 2,400 years later, his methods are still being taught in military academies across the world, including Great West Point. Apart from the fact that he was a military genius, it was his great sense of self-worth, self-determination, that allowed him to stand out from his compares. What did it come down to? In other words, from a very early age, his mother instilled in him, that's Olympias, instilled in him that he was a son of a god, the son of Zeus. And that drove his level of confidence, his level of self-worth, self-determination, that drove him to be the best that he could possibly be. In other words, that whether it was flawed or not, what that led to was such a strong feeling of self-confidence. Eventually, it led to hubris, which the Greeks call, Greeks have this term hubris, which was this almost self-pride or self-worth on steroids, is where you become haughty, and it's where you believe too much in yourself and in your own abilities and in your own power. So he developed hubris. But that was one of the flaws of his character. Again, the Greeks call it a hamartia, a fatal flaw. So, but eventually, earlier on, what he was able to do was to use that self-determination, the concept of a strong self, to really drive him to be as good as any and better than many. In other words, he set his life's goal to surpass all the great feats of the great heroes before him, Achilles and whomever else, whether they were mythical or not, Achilles, Hercules, all of these great figures, he wanted to surpass them, do what they did, surpass them, and set the bar higher, extend the frontier, push the boundaries of what was humanly possible, and in a way, immortalize himself. In other words, make his feats so immortal. In fact, he said, it is a lovely thing to live with passion and to die leaving an everlasting fame. In a way, Alexander did that, because 2,400 years later, people are still talking about him. His methods are still being taught. In a way, he's gained immortality through his great military feats. At the end of the day, that's what it amounts to. Of course, Alexander had many bad traits about him. Everybody in history has had bad traits about
like any, right.
Like anybody else. But I think what it amounts to was he has to be credited for developing that strong sense of self, that strong sense of self-worth, strong sense of self-determination. And that was what drove him to be the greatest, in my book, the greatest military commander the world has ever seen. And I'm putting him in with Genghis Khan and Hannibal Barca and all of those.
Well-read.
Well, I tried.
Which is a good thing.
Right. But what he was able to do, and so in other words, for me to declare him, in my view, the best, the greatest military mind the world has ever seen, is not an easy, in other words, it's not a fluke. In other words, I'm very fastidious in that. It is because I think that he was able to mix and mingle not just great military genius, but a sense of self-worth, a sense of almost invincibility. In other words, he believed in his dreams, he pushed for them, he worked hard at them, and he was convinced that nothing was going to stop him from accomplishing what he wanted to. So in other words, I raise the example of Alexander to say that was the kind of ethos, that's the kind of spirit that drives my own pursuits. In other words, nothing is going to stop me from accomplishing what I want to do, and no extraneous factor, no exogenous circumstances are going to allow me to not be who I want to be. So in other words, self-contentment, I'm always good. I'm always fantastic because I will myself to be fantastic. In other words, I don't let circumstances surrounding me influence what I am. I allow myself to influence the circumstances around me.
Yes, thank you for that. That was powerful. I think that was very profound, what you just said. And what I noticed in what you just said is, for example, my understanding of what you said with regards to Alexander is he saw the manifestation of greatness around him and he allowed that to impact him. And what I got from what you just said is you may not have had at your fingertips in your physical space this kind of greatness that you looked up to, but you tapped into it through books or whatever means that were accessible to you, and you are still able to connect to it. Because I think one of the challenges that it's not about race, but Black people or poor people faces, they're not used, there's a psychology of failure, I think, built up from not having been exposed tremendously to winning and greatness. And so they can know that, okay, this many persons have done this great thing, I can do it too. And also, which I think is critical, is we're not very exposed to the positive impact of failure, because we're taught failure is bad, it's terrible, you must just sit down and be calm and be a particular way. And so we have to find a way, I guess, to tap into those things that is not at our fingertips in order to connect and understand that there's better and that there's greater. Travel did that for me, and that's why I'm a travel blogger, right? So when someone asks you, based on what you're saying to me, it sounds to me that whether they ask you or they're not, but when someone says to you, how are you today, it's not, your subconscious is already in the mindset of all is well. So it's because exactly. Some persons respond without thinking about it. We just say something, you know, there's no forethought about it. So that's what you're saying. You've cemented this already. And so your subconscious has caught up with your conscious. There is harmony, because for some persons, we're not very, our consciousness and our subconscious is so hidden because it's so sometimes buried in pain, as coaching, you know, principles of coaching indicate. So you want a minute?
No, that's fine.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is living in contentment or acceptance of poverty a crutch? Is it when for persons who, well, let me just ask, is living in contentment an acceptance of poverty?
No. In other words, what it is, not necessarily,
mm-hmm.
but that contentment has to be complemented by a striving, an insatiable striving for better.
Yes.
In other words, the contentment comes from accepting the fact that this is the present reality, but it also mm-hmm. the striving for better is part and parcel of accepting that there can be a better reality. I'm going to strive for that. So in other words, what is key is that, fine, the contentment comes from not worrying unduly about it, because that comes from accepting that you can emerge from that, you can climb from that, you can elevate yourself from that through strong self-will, through strong determination, through strength of character, through hard work, through discipline, through focus, through commitment. So in other words, there are two things. The contentment by itself could be construed as an acceptance of what it is, the present circumstances. Contentment doesn't come from that. It comes from a realization that this might be how it is now, but tomorrow will present other opportunities which will be exploited. So there's a twin, there's a double element to this idea of contentment.
And there has
now
to be a willingness.
And tomorrow.
Oh,
right.
Sorry. Go ahead.
No, in terms of now and tomorrow, accepting mm-hmm. what it is now, and also ensuring that you work hard to change it tomorrow.
Right. So there has to be a willingness to decide and to choose to do something about it.
Precisely.
Because there's
Precisely.
Some persons who worry perpetually.
mm-hmm. And that
right.
doesn't help. That doesn't
okay.
help.
So would you say then that this whole principle of contentment is not necessarily that we are saying, in whatever state of mind you are, in whatever state of socioeconomic status or standing you are, be glad and be happy and stay there and chill. That's not what you're saying.
No, absolutely.
You're saying accept what is your reality and then do something about it, not
Precisely.
Worry about it.
Precisely.
Because, okay, worry by default is an acceptance that there can be no better.
Precisely, because it is said that worrying is like being in a rocking chair. It keeps you occupied, but gets you nowhere. So the point is that
exactly.
you'd want to ensure that, in other words, what it is, you do a status assessment. You do a kind of assessment of the present situation, a situational analysis. This is precisely, this is where it is now. And then you strategize how to emerge from that. And that's what, for example, Alexander was able to do. He was able to look in every battle he entered, and there were four major battles that he had, and they were extraordinarily impressive victories. They were all, in every one of those battles, he was outnumbered. At the Battle of Gaugamela, one of his greatest battles in modern day Iraq, he was outnumbered about 5-1. He strategized, he looked what needed to have been done. It was a content, it was a kind of calm, cool contentment that came from not necessarily accepting defeat. That would have suggested that he was going to accept defeat. I'm outnumbered, I'm going to be defeated. He understood and accepted he was outnumbered. But then what did he do about it? The contentment that he showed came from a strategy around it, and it turned out to have been a genius strategy to have, as I said, still being studied in all military academies around the world today, including the great West Point, looking at what needed to have been done within the context of the present circumstances. So not accepting the present circumstances as the status quo all the time, as the perennial status quo, but understanding that you have the power to change it, and you're going to exert yourself, exert your will, exert your confidence and your conviction on the present reality to bend it in your favor.
That's the premise of coaching as well. Stating the reality, accepting that this is what is, so you can have a clear mind to strategize to move forward.
Precisely.
No, for me, that's kind of come naturally for me. So I guess that's why I didn't get lost along the way, because I'm naturally a strategist. Like, I'm always, from 8 years old, when I was eight, that's how I figured the cross, where I thought, okay, how do I use the cross? On one side, what I have, on the other side, what can I do with it? So it's something I've always done. Do you think that poverty is psychologically paralyzing? Can it be?
Yes, of course, easily. It has paralyzed a lot of people, because they've accepted it almost as their reality, and it has defined their reality. It has defined their sense of self-worth. It has also been intergenerational. It has been, and that's how it has created a vicious cycle, because successive generations have seen this as a reality that perhaps can't be broken, almost as if it's an irreparable situation. And I think that's obviously, that's been psychologically paralyzing, and it has created an ethos, almost a subculture, in which people see it as something that, you know, there's no way.
This
you
is can what get I am.
It. This is the present reality. There's no way you can get out of it. You just have to work within the confines of that. So they tie themselves into a box. They tether themselves to their own realities, instead of seeing that, instead of focusing on the aspirational goals of emerging from that predicament.
Right. I think you have a very good mastery of mind. It's my personal opinion. Mm-hmm. Do you think so?
Absolutely. And I think that we only need to understand and accept how powerful our minds are. I think most people do not accept and understand how powerful their minds are. It's amazing, for example, there was this movie I was told about. I saw bits and pieces of it. I think it might have been Lucy or one of them, which talks about what you could only accomplish if you used, say, 20% of your brain capacity. And the more you go, the more almost otherworldly things you can accomplish. In other words, we do not accept and understand how powerful we are. What is in our heads is like a universe in and of itself. It's as complex as the boundless universe that we strive to go towards. Man strives to go as far as possible into the universe, beyond our solar system and so on. We have a universe in our heads, in our minds, that we have not fathomed, we have not tapped into, because we do not accept the power of our minds. We have to, that's where the changing of our realities comes from. It comes from within. And that is what we project on our reality, to bend it in our favor.
Mm-hmm. How does someone who has not yet, well, I have this, I accept the thought that everyone is where they want to be, and everyone is doing exactly what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it upsets people when I say that, but I know it's the case, because the fact of the matter is, when we get really uncomfortable, no matter what's going on, we get up and we move. It's a natural thing where we do not do what, nobody can get someone to do what they don't really want to do. Now, I think that the creator, when he created the mind, I think it was very smart because I've never heard of anyone being able to go into the mind without your permission to do anything to it, the way they can go to the brain, the other organs in the body. I think we don't even know where it is. Right? So, what do you say to someone who thinks that, for example, I get a lot of questions on my Facebook page about people saying that poor people act the way they do because religion sometimes messes them up, and they're the ones controlling their minds, or it's the news, or it's the this and it's the that controlling their minds and things like that. What do you say to somebody like that who thinks they are where they are because of everything else that's happening around them? How do they master their mind, in your own opinion?
There are forces and there are countervailing forces. As simple as that. There are going to be extraneous, exogenous forces which are going to try to influence and impact on your reality. You can have a countervailing force to push back against that. What is that countervailing force which pushes back
Yes,
against
please
that?
simplify for me.
It's simple.
Yes.
What we've been talking about, your strength of mind.
Right.
If you tell yourself that your reality is going to be this, and the entire world around you is telling you that your reality is going to be another thing, then it becomes a battle of wills. It becomes a matter of which force is stronger, the force that is trying to exert a pressure and an influence on you, or is it your own pushback force, your countervailing force that tries to push back and repel those negative influences? It becomes a matter of that. If there's peer pressure, why is it that some children succumb to negative peer pressure and some children don't? Obviously, there are countervailing forces for those who do not succumb to negative peer pressure. They are able to exert enough pressure in pushing back against the negative peer pressure. Whether it is a strong family background, whether it is a strong faith, whether it is a strong sense of self-belief and self-worth and self-determination and conviction, whatever it is, those are the incorporeal forces, the intangible forces, the subliminal forces, which are going to be pushing back against these forces from the outside. Again, everything in the universe is about balance. It's about balance of forces. There's gravity, there's a weak electromagnetic force, and there's a strong electromagnetic force. All of these forces are in perfect alignment and balance. We have to find a way to have an equilibrium so that the negative forces which are impacting on us do not, suck us in, do not essentially cause us to implode. You see, what happens with a black hole is that the gravity is so strong that the star actually collapses upon itself, and not even light can escape the strength of the gravity. In other words,
But
that is a situation.
how do you develop that kind of gusto though? That kind of, I am a strong personality in that not a lot of persons can really change my mind when I make it up, and I do not allow myself to be bullied only because I'm so stubborn and lazy. I believe I'm lazy because I only do the things that I really love to do, right? So it's hard for you to get me to do if I don't want to do something, I'm telling you. But there are other persons who are not so strong. How do they develop that kind of, have you ever had your strong sense of self tested? Have you
There's a
not?
test. Of
Have you
course,
not?
those tests will come all the time. That's why there are
Have you ever
these.
had it so tested that you've had to, well, I'm not gonna say cry, but you've had to question yourself or go re-strategize, or you buckle? Like, has that
No,
ever happened? No?
no. I mean, in other words, there have been stronger pressures and tests than at other times. In other words, the intensity of the tests vary. The intensity varies, but it is never a matter that you're going to buckle under it. In other words, whatever the intensity of the extraneous forces, you're going to match that by your own inner strength. So in other words, you need to turn up the ante, you need to turn up the heat on your inner strength to push back against it. As I said, it becomes a
Yes.
matter of forces.
Yes.
As I said, a star that becomes a black hole collapses upon itself because the pressure from outside, the pressure of gravity, is so great for the star to be able to push back. In other words, why has the sun not collapsed into a black hole and essentially wiped out the entire solar system? It's because the activity within the sun, is keeping the gravity at bay so that there is an equilibrium there, so that the sun doesn't collapse upon itself. What we have to do is, no matter how strong the forces on the outside are, we develop the inner strength to be able to push back against that. So the stronger the pressure, the stronger your will needs to be to push back against it.
And that
will comes from your sense of what you want to accomplish. Are you driven? Are you motivated to accomplish what you want to accomplish? Because in other words, it becomes a matter of wills. It becomes a battle of wills.
Can I tell you something? I fully understand what you're saying, and I'm so happy I had you on, because you're one of those positive persons, and I've had to change my entire network to having people around me that think like that. So I have that now. But I have wondered, I still wonder if you've done coaching. Like a friend, I think he does coaching. Okay. Like, it's like the principles, the techniques that we use in coaching, like you already have it, right? And one of the things I think is that coaching, and I'm not knocking counseling or anything, but I think coaching and therapy should be applied from primary school for Caribbean nationals, or Black people, to override the people like me who came from no home, okay, that was not a home, and you have a lot of other persons who were not coming from any construct or institution that is supposedly the family. There isn't such a construct for a lot of persons. And so for someone who doesn't know, who looks at you and thinks, damn, he just does it so naturally, how do they cross over to where you are? Like, how do they, does that make sense to you? Right.
Yeah, that's what you're saying. Look, and my simple response to that is there no one size fits all. So in other words, there's no one silver bullet, there's no one panacea that's going to work for everybody. It becomes a situation where each person has to determine for him or herself what is the best fit that works in terms of ensuring ultimately the end game. It's like spokes in a bicycle wheel. Different spokes, but they all lead to the center of the bicycle wheel. Different people will try different avenues to get there. But essentially,
what do you recommend?
The end game. But the end game is, yes, the end game is what you want to accomplish, which is a place at which, a point at which, you are so focused on your goals, you are so driven by the need to accomplish your goals, no matter what, that you're going to ward off whatever pressures you're
that's
going to
push.
That's
if you have goals, right?
But that's the first point. You have to be able to clearly define what you want to accomplish in life.
Right.
Alexander was clear. He
so
wanted,
that could be number one. Have
right.
an end in mind, clearly defined.
Absolutely. So the end game, and then you have a clear goal, clear aspiration, and it has to be something that's transcendent, something that's larger than you, almost larger than life. Aim as high as you possibly can. Aim for the stars if you need to. In other words, why not? Why should you constrain yourself? Your mind is already boundless. Aim as high as you possibly can. Be the greatest that you can possibly be. And here's a rule of thumb. Whatever your field of endeavor, aim to be the best in that field of endeavor. So aim for the very top. There's no reason why you can't be an Einstein if you're in science. Or there's no reason why you can't be an Alexander if you're in military if you're in military spheres. Or there's no reason why you can't be a Picasso if you're an artist. My point is, whatever field you are in, aim to be the very best at it. Then you clearly set out objectives, you clearly set out timelines, deliverables, when you want to, you know, where should you be at a particular point, and you keep that goal uppermost in your mind. That becomes almost an antidote for the negative influences that are exerting themselves on you. All of a sudden, you're able to quench, it's almost like arrows coming in, and you're able to quench them because you have that antidote.
Yes.
Your will, it drives your will, it inflames your passion for what you want to do, it drives your sense of self. Strength, self-conviction, self-determination.
Your will becomes your antidote.
Exactly. And all of a sudden, those negative influences can't seem to find any way in because your will is already repelling them.
Yes.
And the matter of repelling is an important point. You repel these negative influences through a determination of what you want to do, what you want to accomplish.
Yes.
Look, let's make the point. All great people who have accomplished great things in life have never done it in any other way. They've set themselves clear goals. They have used that as the driving force to propel, to catalyze their, you know, to push them. And what this has done is to, along the way, there have been many difficulties, I'm sure, many difficulties. But you
and
look
failures.
At what, absolutely, but you learn from them. You pick yourself up.
Fail forward.
You, exactly, and you're always focusing on going forward. You almost blinker like a horse. You're not looking to the left or to the right, you're looking at forward. And you're driven to accomplish this because it is such a burning desire inside of you to accomplish these goals that you're able to repel any sort of influences, any sort of negative influences.
With that said, do you think then that one of the things that parents can do when they have their children, just to kind of shift the mindsets, is to from very early give your children, help your children decide on a goal?
Yes, I think that would help. Make it
okay.
clear. And as you mentioned earlier, it is important for there to be...
Sorry.
Right. It
and,
is important
and
for
not,
there to be
not an educational
role
goal, so to speak. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yes. It is important for there to be good role models, for example. And
well,
it might be an issue, for example, about for black people, why it is that they have not
yes.
really found good role, model, good role models. In other words, why is it that people... apparently, it's an educational issue. Young children should learn about great conquerors in history, great achievers in history of
right.
all races, including their own, including, for example, young people going to schools in countries of the African diaspora should learn, for example, about Mansa Musa, who crossed at the time of Timbuktu, who crossed the desert with, pretty much in a caravan of gold, one of the richest people in history in terms of when Timbuktu was Timbuktu, well, modern-day Mali in Africa. In terms of great African civilizations, great achievers, great people who have accomplished great things. And in other words, look at it from all races. In other words, it transcends race to tell them that, look, you can accomplish whatever you will. Nothing should constrain you, whether it is the circumstances of your birth, your skin color, your race, your creed, whatever it is, you can surmount all these challenges. You can be just as great as anybody who has developed. See, because we've had great black conquerors, we've had great black achievers and inventors, and all the spheres that you can think of, black people have accomplished that. So in other words, your race should have nothing to do with it. Where you're from should have nothing to do with it.
Abraham Lincoln. Why do you think it impacts it though then? Because the risk of failure is almost paralyzing to people. It's like, I don't know that because I am always willing to, I revel in my failure, I really do, and maybe too much, right? Because I feel like the more I fail, the greater the idea post-fail, right? And I'm not a good person with commitment, and guess maybe that's why I like to see things break apart so I can rebuild it. It's fascinating for me, right? But for some persons, they just can't get over that threshold. I remember you said to me one, I think it's back in 2008, you said to me, courteous to all, intimate with few. Where did that come from?
I think it might have been from my reading. I don't think that was an original thought. I think it might have been from my reading. I read very widely, and I read about people from all different eras in history.
Yes.
I'm particularly interested in ancient history. I like the fact that whatever we're experiencing now is no different. As Solomon said, there's nothing new under the heavens.
Do you think
life
that may be why
wrong.
It's so hard? Do
no,
you
no,
think
no.
it's lack of exposure? So, for example, you're so correct about the reading or the exposure to new information. I have a women empowerment blog that I do where I use travel as my exposure. Like I say, get out of your house, get out of your community, get out of your parish, get out of your country, get to know new culture. Because when I got exposed to new culture, and I've always read a lot, Harley Quinn and them things, but it still exposed me to a lot of different cultures and ways of doing things. So do you think that could have been what really... Well, it sounds to me like you're saying that's in addition to your self-concept that your parents ensured you had. Reading also was pivotal for you, or essential for you, to get you into the mindset of greatness.
Absolutely. What it does is to shape your worldview. Everybody has to have a worldview. What do you think of the world around you, and how do you see your place in it? So it shapes your worldview. And I think that provides a foundation on which you can build. So it provides a worldview, a thought, an overarching thought that is going to drive your own sense of self, your own place in the world. In other words, you have to see yourself as a child of the universe, no less, as the song says, no less than the trees and the stars. You have a right.
And not just the spot you're standing in universe, precisely, the real.
Precisely. And in other words, what that does is to drive your own feeling of locus. As the lawyers would say, my legal colleagues would say, locus standi. It gives you your sense of locus. You have a right to be here. And this is your place in the world. This is your place among, in other words, you stand among equals. Not an inferior place in this thing. So what?
No matter who you are, what your education.
And where you're from. Absolutely.
Oh, I like
you have
that.
An equal place. You have locus. And you have an equal right. In as much as you breathe the air, the oxygen in the air, and you drink the water around you, you have also an equal right and a privilege to accomplish anything you want. Now, but the outcomes, let me say this to you. There's an equality. My view, my worldview, is that there must be an equality of opportunity, not necessarily an equality of outcome. What you do with the opportunity, everybody should be equal in terms of the opportunities presented to them.
Right.
But not everybody should be equal in terms of the outcomes. What the outcome is depends on what you do with your opportunity. So in other words, the concept of socialism is based on everybody pretty much should have the same outcomes. My concept is that everybody should have the same opportunities. In other words, everybody should not necessarily have a house. If you didn't work hard for it, you must work hard. I believe in meritocracy. When I say everybody deserves to have a house, but if somebody doesn't work hard and somebody just works 100% harder and has a house, the person who doesn't work hard shouldn't begrudge the person who worked hard for the house that they have. In other words, there should be an equality. Everybody has the same opportunities. At the start of a 100-meter race, everybody starts at the same line. Everybody hears a gun the same time. Everybody moves the same time. If you move before, you're disqualified. False start. But everybody moves at the same time. But what happens at the end of the 100 meters is a matter, it comes down to you. Your training, your how much you want it, your focus, your determination, your skill, all of that comes into determining who wins the race and who comes second.
Yeah. I have three more questions.
Mm-hmm. Right. I'm trying to wrap them up.
I know. What lessons have you learned outside of your reading in life? What life lessons have you learned from failing forward that you would like to share with whoever's listening?
From what? From failing forward, you said?
Yeah. Or like, have you ever failed at anything? And when I say failed, I don't necessarily not have the outcome you wanted at the time you expected it, or not having the outcome you thought it would be, but perhaps it turned out to be something bigger.
Yeah, I think there have been many of those occasions when things didn't turn out the way I wanted. I remember, for example, one particular point when I was supposed to have won. Well, that was a view of many people around me. I was participating in the oratorical contest, a speech competition from the Optimist Club in 1996 or 97, one of them, when I was in fourth form. And that was in 95, 96, one of them. Might have been 96. And, you know, it was a disappointment. I felt badly about it. In other words, I should have won, but because there was a slight mix-up in communication, it turned out I didn't win. 2 years later, I actually didn't win again because there was another problem. Again, the judges indicated, and everybody in the audience indicated, I deserve to have won. I moved on from that on the basis that, look, don't cry over spilt milk. Never cry over spilt milk.
Oh, I know. You're like that. I don't know how you do it.
Move on. Things have a way of not working on sometimes. You have no control over it. Move on. In other words, move on to the greater accomplishments of the future. See that as a kind of primer for what's to come and move on to greater accomplishments of the future.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What does happiness mean to you?
Contentment. It's tied up in contentment. In other words, being able to define your own space, define your own reality, and not be influenced by the reality of others. That way, you're always inherently happy because you determine. In other words, nobody turns on and turns off your happiness. You determine that for yourself. So happiness is contentment and the ability to be able to define your own reality.
Okay. When I started this podcast, a person said to me, why would you call it Finding Happy? That's the name of my book, by the way. Mm-hmm. And
congratulations on that.
Thank you. I guess it's my way of healing. It's something that comes naturally for me. But do you think that it is relevant for us to have these conversations?
Absolutely. I think it is important for us to interrogate why it is that we have not, for example, reached the point that we should in life, which is contentment, which is self-actualization. In other words, we should have those discussions. We should, because sometimes it is for lack of having those discussions why we continue to perpetuate that cycle. In other words, we must interrogate it. We must interrogate the present circumstances and try to fix them. And not just, not just a kind of pedantic discussion, but a meaningful discussion that's going to lead to results. I think, as you rightly said earlier, we could start in the schools. So there are a lot of things that we should start with primary school students, even from before that, even at early childhood level, we should instill in our young people, in our young children, these concepts, these principles, these values, this worldview that is going to define who they are as adults. And I think partly it's because of there hasn't been this wide enough focus on these areas in the very earliest stages of the education.
It's true. You're supposed to get an education. You're supposed to grow up and get a job. But there's no conversation about make sure you're at peace with what you're doing. Make sure you like what you're doing. As a matter of fact, these conversations, I think, is very relevant. It's very people on the job. And Gallup's showed that 87% of persons are not engaged in their work. And one of the things I've always wanted to ask you, so I'm just going to ask you, and this is the last question, for real. Mm-hmm. How do you have progressed very well and clearly, well, maybe I already know the answer to the question. You seem to have, you already knew who you were. You knew what you wanted and you seem to have gone straight into the role that you wanted. Of who you wanted to become, right? And then you went from one job to the next steadily in the very role that you desire to be in, correct?
Yes.
How does one do that? Like, how does one do that? A lot of persons that I meet, they may have worked somewhere for 20 years or 17 years or whatever, but they've been miserable. I don't do miserable well. So as soon as I get miserable, I quit. So how do you have this longevity? How do you navigate your career path so well?
The focus on what it is end game. I want to be the greatest in my field. Simple. Whatever the field you are in, be the greatest in it. Set your goal to be the greatest in it.
I think you're one of the very best.
Well, thank you for that. If you want to be a doctor, be the very best doctor there's ever been. If you want to be, so whatever your field is, aim to be the very best at it. That focus will take you through, and all of a sudden, if you keep that as the end game, you realize that you really don't have a challenge. There really is no challenge, because all of a sudden, that becomes the overarching ethos, which drives your career, which drives your path. Because you're focusing on the end goal. You're not focusing on the challenges, not the hurdles, not the encumbrances. You're focusing on the end game, which is to be the very best at your field. Simple as that.
Yeah. I do. You know what I think? As I'm going to close now and release you to your work. I think that we have failed at capturing the thoughts of those that we see succeed and excel. Like, I don't believe in any heroes that I never know. And that's just me personally. I'm not saying they're not heroes to somebody. They're not my hero. I don't know you. I didn't see what you do. And based on what I'm seeing right now, I'm not inclined to believe you are any different. Not saying that you weren't, right? So I think that we have failed to capture the concepts, the thoughts process of people like yourself and other persons who, especially the elderly, to really understand what were some of the things that happened, so we can really tap, because we have this tendency to say it's because of our history, Black people, it's because of the slavery, it's because of this, it's because of that. But we don't even know what this or that is. We never lived in those times. So how are we stuck in those times? So thank you for coming and having the conversation, because I really, really think that it's missing. And that's why I'm very selective with the persons I bring on my show, because this is my healing process. I'm finding my happy.
Excellent. And
I hope you had a good time.
Absolutely did. It is good to articulate some of these views, which have always define who I am.
Yes, I hope I have you back. Okay. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Well, as soon as I'm available, I'll be back with you. Not a problem. As soon as we work out, as long as we don't have those little challenges. The technology. There you go.
Well, I'm thankful for technology. I'm thankful for delays. I'm thankful for everything.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Thanks so much. Really appreciate being with you.
Yeah, thank you. And have a lovely day.
Have a lovely day. Have a fantastic day.
I certainly will.
All right, no problem. Take care.
Okay, bye. Yes. All
right. Thank you so much for listening in on this podcast. I would like to leave these three thoughts with you. So if you take nothing from the time we spent here having this conversation, I hope you take this with you, okay? Learn what is truly important to you. You personally, learn what is truly important to you on a personal, individual level, without any external influences. If there was one thing you could not live without, what is it? Go discover it. Learn what is truly important to you personally. Second, be conscious of the things you say, especially to yourself. Be conscious of the things you say. Check your on-the-fly communication. What do you say without thinking? Become conscious of your words. And finally, what are the things, or who are the people in your life that you only tolerate? Do you hoard things and people? Because some things and some people come in our lives for a season and a reason. And we have the tendency sometimes to hoard them, to hang on to them and refuse to let them go. Refusing to let them go. Whatever you tolerate, you worry about. Whatever you tolerate, you worry about. Some of us may be able to quit worrying or negative influences cold turkey. However, for most of us, it will take emptying our minds first and then a reconditioning from negative thinking to mindfulness and positive thinking. You have to decide that you matter. You have to choose the circumstances that foster your happiness, or choose to create those circumstances that foster your own happiness. Take the steps. And listen, don't be afraid to make decisions in your best interest. Being selfish is not a bad thing. Being narcissistic is a bad thing. Being selfish is a good thing. You've got to love yourself first, yes? So you have to choose the conditions and the circumstances and the situations that will foster your happiness. Take the steps that are necessary so you can begin to choose you. And that may mean getting help. That may mean consulting a coach. That may mean getting a therapist. But you've got to, if you matter, and if you're complaining, and if you're saying something in your life isn't working out, why wouldn't you make the decision? Why wouldn't you make the choice to get the help you need to make the change that you need? Because a lot of times we think we can make these changes on our own and just go cold turkey. To get what you don't have, you have to do what you have not yet done, right? So quit simply complaining. And I'm not saying complaining is bad. By any means, get it out of your head. Vent however it helps you, right? But that must be temporary. It must have a time period where you stop and go change your situation, all right? So take the steps that are necessary so you can begin to choose you and be well. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, please leave it in the comment section. To join me in a conversation on Finding Happy Podcast, contact me via certifiedcoach.co. Thank you so much for listening. It was such a great conversation today with Garfield. I enjoyed it and I hope you did too. Have a great day. Bye-bye.